Hello everyone, thank you for joining us today for this Drupal webinar. Hopefully you can all hear me loudly and clearly. So this webinar today is on how you can ignite and accelerate your Drupal 7 to Drupal 9 migration. We have some fantastic talks for you today with speakers from Acquia and Cyberduck. Just before we get started, just go through the house rules. So the webinar today will last for an hour. As you know, we have been streamed on Zoom, and there will be time at the end for any questions you may have. If you want to submit a question, please use the Q&A window. You can locate this using the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. We are also on social media. We're on LinkedIn, Twitter, and Facebook. And you can also use the hashtag DrupalDuck after this webinar if you have any questions. So let's quickly meet our speakers today. So we have Lisa and Sylvain from Cyberduck and Dave from Acquia. So Lisa, hello. Can you please just introduce yourself and tell all of our attendees about what you do at Cyberduck?
Sure. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the webinar. I'm Lisa Karaleva. I'm project manager in Cyberduck. I work on projects with different clients of different scale, including those which require migration from Drupal 7 to Drupal 9. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Sylvain, same. Can you just give us a quick hello and tell everyone a little bit about what you do?
Yeah. Hi, everyone. So I'm the client services officer at Cyberduck, and I help our team scope initial clients' requirements and turn them into kind of viable and efficient solution, making sure we deliver quality and value for money throughout.
Thank you much. And finally, we also have Dave from Acquia. Hi, Dave. How are you today? Tell us a little bit about what you do at Acquia.
Great. Thanks, Dan. So yeah, Dave Thomas, I'm a solutions consultant at Acquia. And I like to focus on business priorities, on opportunities and challenges, and try and align those with technical solutions.
Brilliant. Thank you very much for that. So just before we get into the talk today, I just want to give you a bit more of an introduction to who we are at Cyberduck and the work we do. So we're a digital transformation agency. We have 15 years experience working on complex websites, content, and mobile. We have a fantastic team who, through their great work, have built our recognition and expertise in UX design and web development. So through our work over the last 15 years, we've been able to sort of develop our own methodologies in everything from user research to UX and accessibility through to auditing and DevOps. In terms of our expertise with CMS, well, we're experts across lots of them, but we do very much favor Drupal, especially when powered by Acquia. Over the last several years, we've worked on some fantastic Drupal projects with clients such as Sport England, College Policing, and Commonwealth. So for instance, our work with Sport England, well, our team was faced with the challenge of multiple websites, a wealth of content, and a broad and diverse audience. So our team undertook a substantial user research, as well as content, UX, and accessibility auditing. And we identified a better way to segment the wide and diverse audience that Sport England's digital content addressed, and found solutions to consolidate these websites and reduce all their technical content debt. The end result has been a really brilliant website that has, over the last kind of 12 months, been able to build up lots of award recognition. So another client of ours is College of Policing. So they were looking for an experienced delivery partner who could provide them with the essential technical design and tactical support to really complete the transition and migration of college microsites. Similar to Sport England, this project was truly a team effort. We employed expertise across audience research, UX design, and development. But really our passion for Drupal goes beyond this. Some of you may have been to previous Drupal webinars that we've run. We ran one early in the year, actually I think it was last year now, with a panel of Drupal experts and people in the Drupal community. We've also launched a ebook on Drupal 9 to really help educate businesses about getting ready for Drupal 9 and what it means for them. We're a Acquia and Drupal partner. And earlier this year, both Sylvain, who's one of our speakers today, and our CEO, Danny, spoke at DrupalCon Europe. DrupalCon North America, in fact. And, you know, Danny did a really fantastic presentation looking really at content and PDF accessibility also looking at what Drupal now are doing around accessibility, a subject that's very much passionate at CyberDuck. So now I will pass on to Sylvain, who will be doing our first presentation for today.
Thanks, Dan. So yeah, let's start. Let's talk about Drupal. Yeah, I think that's why you're here today. So from Drupal's own research, there's still around two-thirds of the websites that are using Drupal 7 or lower version of that CMS. So it shows that only a small percentage of websites have actually upgraded to the latest version of Drupal, the latest stable release now, that's 9. And obviously with Drupal 7 coming end of life next year, it's really time to stop delaying and kicking the can down the road. And if you've not looked into it yet, you really need to start upgrading your Drupal 6 or 7 content management system. And you might be wondering, why should I upgrade? You've probably heard about this end of life things and what does it mean? So the first thing obviously is that Drupal 7 is almost 15 years old now. So the way it was built back then has a lot of convoluted ways and it's an outdated framework. And the end of life date that you've heard for this year for Drupal 8 and next year for Drupal 7 means that the ongoing support for the framework past that date will be very limited and will be the exception, not the norm. And you don't want to be the last one running on outdated technology. And the final point is that it's not efficient. Whether you consider your editors, like the staff that's using the content management system every day, or the developers who are working on your platform, either building new feature or maintaining it. As you work on older and older software, everything will take longer. You won't have time to retrain and develop kind of efficient processes throughout. So when you think about value for money, it's not the best decision to stay on Drupal 7. But there's light at the end of the tunnel because Drupal 9 is the future. The underlying framework is using all the latest modern development standards. It's been optimized for mobile performance, it's more accessible themes. It's really the future of content management systems. And because of that, it will continue to receive most of the community effort and the investment in building all the new modules, those components that enrich your content management system. So introduction of the layout builder, for example, in Drupal 9 is a great improvement. And we really feel that all the new and future improvements will only be made for Drupal 9 and above and not on the old platform. And the main pain point of any content management system, whether you're running Braco or WordPress or any other systems, is the ongoing patching and the security service patch that you need to apply. And for that, in Drupal 10, there's amazing plans to automate most of those upgrades. So it will really be a bliss, it will be more efficient, it will save time for everyone, and we can't wait for that to happen. So in terms of the migration to move away from Drupal 7, as you can see, it's a lot of work. It's the move from 7 and 8, because of the new frameworks I mentioned, it's typically several weeks or a month of work because you need to consider the data structure, you need to migrate the contents, you need to make sure the modules are still compatible. And there, as I mentioned, this new theming engine, you need to recode your template and most of the front end. Whereas the move from Drupal 8 to Drupal 9 is actually only a few days of work. We've done it recently for a client, and the whole end-to-end process from initial to going live took less than a couple of weeks. Because it's the same underlying framework, most of it is automated. It's only minor specification that we had to tweak. So it's really something that you need to plan ahead of time and get the ball rolling. But it's not only a technical story. Obviously, we're talking about the upgrade of the core framework. But when you embark on such a revamp, most of the time might also be a good idea to audit your entire digital strategy, because we assume your website is the primary touch point on the web. So you probably a good point would be a good moment to reconsider your user experience. Is your website still optimized and providing clear user journey for your customers? Or is the content still up to date? And is your kind of your governance process on how you manage and publish and decommission content in the content management system, is that all efficient and spread across your team? You need to think about the impact on SEO and making sure you're using all the latest search engine optimization techniques to comply and make sure you're not penalized by the new Google Core Web Vitals algorithm, for example. And then obviously accessibility, which has a big push these days. There's regulation that come into place that makes it mandatory to achieve a certain level of compliance for public sector organization. And even in the corporate world now, you can't bypass this anymore. And you really have to deliver accessible service for all your users. And in terms of upgrading to Drupal 9, again, the process is well-defined, like it's publicly available on the Drupal website, is well-documented. The community has been working on it for years now. And as I said, there is everything around content, the migration of the content types, the actual data, the media library, rebuilding the theme, testing all your modules, and run the full regression to make sure the new site still performs. So the process is clear. However, each code base, each website is very different. There's lots of websites that we came across have custom modules that over the years, different agencies or developers have built. And every website is very different. So as you can imagine, all of those steps can quickly become very time consuming and expensive. And that's why we've partnered with Acquia, because being a core contributor to the platform, they came up with a solution that makes this process much easier. So I'll hand over to Dave now to tell you more about it.
Thanks, Sylvain. yeah, you're right. Just a few quick words on that, on the history behind that. Dan, you can move to the next slide. Acquia is effectively founded to help companies be successful with Drupal. It's been a leader in Gartner and Forrester for a number of years now. You probably already know that our founder and CTO is also the founder of Drupal and the project lead. But a lot of our employees are also heavily engaged in the community. And Acquia contributes more to Drupal than any other organization, as Sylvain said. And we've spent the last 13 or so years delivering high-profile Drupal sites in the cloud, and we currently have over 4,000 customers globally. So when it comes to migrating, not just Drupal 7, but even just migrating in general, we're in a pretty good position to be able to talk to our customers and our partners who've ever already been through this whole process. And we analyzed how the time and the costs associated with Drupal 7 to Drupal 9 migrations were distributed. And this is what we found. On this next slide, you'll see around half of the effort was effectively rebuilding the presentation and the logic, and the other half was migrating data, you know, figuring out what can be migrated and what can't be migrated. And so with this in mind, we developed Acquia Migrate Accelerate, which is an exclusive feature of Acquia Cloud Enterprise. And it provides a set of tools to reduce the time and effort to migrate from an Acquia-hosted Drupal 7 to Drupal 9 by up to 80% in some cases. And as you see, you know, on this next slide, it does this by giving you an environment to work in, firstly, which reduces DevOps completely. I mean, it negates it. It also recommends modules and patches to help smooth out that migration path. And also by creating a migration experience that's accessible to site builders or even non-technical users, rather than having to appeal to developers. And but beyond this, Acquia also provides a few additional solutions, like the Cloud IDE, which is a dev environment which is provisioned in the cloud, and this can help speed up the development velocity when it comes to business logic. And also Site Studio, which is a low-code site builder, and this dramatically reduces the amount of time and the costs associated with bringing that presentation layer from Drupal 7 to Drupal 9. But today, I'm going to specifically focus on the three elements that we see at the top here. So you can see on the first thing that that Migrate Accelerate provides you with is a separate environment that we can run all our migrations from. This means Drupal 7 can continue to run in the production environment until you're effectively ready to flick the switch. And this is why we don't need DevOps to, you know, provision the database, set up the LAMP stack, have an environment set up for us. Effectively, what happens here is the when you create this migration environment, it makes a copy of your production environment and transfers that over to your migration environment. And it provides you with this migration dashboard, which is intuitive and aimed at non-technical people. So the dashboard, as we'll see on the next slide, provides you with an overview of the progress for your migration. It tracks any errors that come up. It also automatically sorts your data migrations into, let's say, workflow sites like in progress or needs review. And it keeps track of dependencies. So you're not wasting time and effort importing things without all the prerequisites being met first. So for example, you can't import article comments unless articles have already been imported. And if you need to roll back at any time, if you need to roll a migration back, you can do that as well. So in the top right corner here, you can see it's gathering a list of validation errors and other errors. And these are there for us to follow up on. And as we'll see on the next slide, these are logged and presented in a dashboard. Now, usually you'd have to run a database query to access these things. And even then you're often left with what are actually fairly cryptic messages sometimes, but Migrate Accelerate provides you with a plain English explanation of the message. But not only that, it also provides suggestions on how the issue can or perhaps even should be resolved according to what best practices are. And this information here can then be handed off to your development team, who will then be provided with these clear instructions, clear directions, and a solid checklist of what needs to be resolved and even how to resolve it. And finally, Migrate Accelerate can also make suggestions on module path upgrades. So the module auditor lists all of the Drupal 9 equivalent modules that have been selected specifically for your Drupal 7 functionality. It might be that the module you're using in Drupal 7 is still active and the upgrade path is simple and obvious, or it could be that the module is actually no longer maintained or even available in Drupal 9. So what Migrate Accelerate will do, it maintains a list of Drupal 7 modules and the corresponding Drupal 9 modules that provide the same level of functionality or the same type of functionality, and it suggests those as replacements. And any module that's had its migration path already vetted by our team, these are going to be marked as Acquia vetted and they'll be installed as default. So if you happen to, beyond that, if you happen to have a module that's that Migrate Accelerate doesn't know about, maybe it's something that you built yourself, like Sylvain mentioned earlier, maybe built by a long time ago. In that case, Migrate Accelerate is going to offer you some pointers to resources to help you port it over. So that's Migrate Accelerate, or AMA, as we tend to call it when you find yourself having to refer to it a lot. it simplifies the migration process really in three ways. It provides you with a dedicated migration environment to work in within your application on Drupal Cloud. It generates a Drupal 9 site with a set of recommended modules and patches based on your Drupal 7 site's functionality. And this helps to smooth out that that migration path. And finally, it leverages the power of the Drupal Migrate API. Rather than needing developers to be involved, it's accessible to site builders. And that means that you don't need these developers to shepherd you through that whole experience. So back over to Survey.
Yeah, thanks, Dave. Great demo. So yeah, as you've all seen, the Acquia Migrate tool can really help speed up the process and reduce the overall time and then directly the overall cost of the migration. But obviously, it's a product that invested a lot of time to build and to make very usable for Drupal customers and site editors. So it's something that requires your website to be hosted on their platform. And if you're not currently an Acquia customer, it will obviously involve a migration. You'll need to move your website and your web platform to their hosting to benefit from it. But that migration can also bring a lot of other benefits. So let's look into more details at some of them. Because we're noticing more and more that a lot of clients that we're taking over or onboarding to manage their web platform or rebuild them, most of the time are not following best practices when it comes to hosting. A lot of government clients now have to follow very strict guidelines from the NCSC and other kind of public sector guidelines. And the corporate companies also have much stricter requirements from dedicated InfoSec team that are vetting every solution, everything that's online has to go through kind of due diligence. And obviously it's understandable with the recent rise of all the data leaks and ransomware hacking, there's a lot more investments and everyone is taking security very, very seriously. And the two main drivers for that is obviously, first of all, securing your data, especially if it contains personal data or customer data. So everything around encryption in the database, protecting the content so it's not tampered with, all your assets, the kind of intellectual property that might be hosted on the web and that you'd want to secure. So the whole security around best practices and managing disaster recovery process needs to be considered. And the second point is the resilience of your hosting platform to make sure the site, the portal doesn't go down when you're running mission critical application used by hundreds of employees during the day, or if you have a transactional website that has to run 24/7, you need to have a resilient system that can scale and doesn't go down every few days. So at CyberDuck, we manage those hosting environment and we are platform agnostic. We do that for clients on AWS, on Microsoft Azure, on the gov.uk PaaS platform. And we can achieve those requirements on any of those platforms. But if you have a Drupal website specifically, the Acquia Cloud has some great credentials. Because as part of their cloud hosting offering, they've achieved all the right accreditation. I was talking about InfoSec due diligence. We've seen kind of they have everything needed from SOC 2, ISO, HIPAA compliance, everything in their enterprise architecture and the SLA that they've give, the uptime guarantee. Everything is great. And the benefit on the SLA is that it's not only for the hosting platform, like the hardware in the cloud hosting, but also at the application level, which is not something you have from AWS and Azure. So their platform guarantees the uptime of your application with the code base, the modules, and all of that. But more importantly, they've also built additional tools to help our client and help ourselves. When we're buying kind of hosting, you think about hosting your websites and the server and the processing power, This is just the hardware. And as I said, at CyberDuck, we have our own DevOps team that can do that. But with all their tools around the deployment and taking care of all the vulnerability management and the remote administration in terms of applying patches to your code base, it frees us up. It frees up our DevOps team and our developer to focus on process and building efficiency into it. And we don't have to deal with those low-level configuration and small patch. So with their hosting platform, basically, we can offload the maintenance of the day-to-day operation on the cloud hosting, and our team can focus on innovation and add value to our clients for their specific needs. And yeah, again, to reemphasize another point and an important consideration when selecting a hosting partner, is the security and the performance. And more than just the cloud hosting, you need to think about the entire environment. And this can be done again manually with a lot of configs or additional tools, but the platform in terms of having DDoS protection, protecting your site against SQL injection, and the CDN, the content delivery network, to load your assets globally. So wherever your customers are in the world, they'll have very quick load time. All of that can be done independently, but when it's all bundled onto one product from one platform, and the cost benefits are just, it's not comparable, basically. It's very important to plan proactively before your website gets into any security risk and before it's too late. So again, think about the when you're planning the upgrades, how it impacts your hosting environment and make sure you're up to the latest standards. I'll now hand over to Lisa to talk a bit less about tech and more about content and upgrades.
Thank you, Sivan. As you say, my talk will be less technical. So things you need to consider before upgrading. As a project manager working with different clients and seeing the end-to-end process, I also see common mistakes. And my role is to foresee such issues and make sure that whole team, including the client, knows what needs to be done in order to avoid any issues. And one of the most common mistakes I always see is that content considers to be something not very important, something easy to do, and quite often delayed till the few weeks before the launch. So the future website designed, it's built, it's migrated, and then when a few times before the launch, the real content needs to be fit in, it just doesn't fit in. And let me give you a few examples. When you build your website based on placeholder content, based on some very simple things, everything looks nice. All text blocks are aligned, imagery sourced, matching brand colors, everything looks really beautiful. But then when you put your real content in, it just doesn't match and website doesn't look so good. So let's say main header banner on the homepage, first that your users see when you enter your website. This header just becomes longer, so that pushes all the content below the fold and it just looks ridiculous. So I need to do something with that. Or let's say amount of content you have to put on the page becomes an unreadable wall of text without any options to engage with readers, without any special blocks to create a quote, for example, or do something else. So again, it just doesn't look as good as in designs. Or you simply need to put some additional types of content, diagram or something like that, and there is no blocks which were designed or built for that. So that delays your launch because you have to troubleshoot those issues somehow. And during those nervous weeks, you either have to rewrite your content, which not always be possible, or rush into developing something new blocks, which may not follow the proper process of design and review. And reviewing all that stuff. So after the launch, you still have to continue fixing some issues. And that all doesn't look right, correct? So we here in CyberDuck, next slide please, suggest you to use different approach and different process. We suggest that you start with research. You research what your users actually need. And you also do your content audit. and see if there is some outdated content that you don't need to migrate. And only when you have your updated and reviewed content and your user needs, then you do your wireframes, which you validate during your user testing. And only then you start your design and build so that once it comes to putting your content in to migrate your content, everything fits in perfectly well, because that was built based on the real content you actually have, and there are no surprises. So you launch everything on time, and after the launch, you can just continue support or even improve what you already have. That sounds much better, I hope. And you can see from that correct process that you will require a big team of people to work on that. This can vary from project to project, from case to case, but that's basically the main people we suggest you should consider. And what is very important to say that even if you have an agency working for you, we still need your involvement, a lot of your involvement, because it's only you know what we need to build, and we need to collaborate constantly to make sure that the project succeeds. And it's very important that, in our case, client is on board and ready to work with us on a daily basis. And this team can be partially on agent side, partially on client side, but that needs to be a one team, which works together towards one goal. And obviously stakeholders will always be on the client side. And it's very important that there is a process, streamlined process, to make sure that stakeholders are informed, updated to the process, and when their approvals required, they have time booked for that, so they don't become any bottlenecks and they don't stop us from progressing. Next slide, please. So it may scare you now because it's a long process, lots of people should be involved, but let's look at the benefits, because it's always a good time to review your website user experience and content, and especially when you are doing some major migrations and anyway need to kind of rebuild your website. So the main advantages of doing the review of content so early are the following. It can save time of your future development. It will for sure improve your user experience, and you also will prepare your team for migration. So let's look into those things one by one. How can it save your time? By reviewing your content, you can realize how much outdated content you have, so you don't need to migrate that. You don't need to develop blocks which will fit them in. Or you also, by reviewing the content, can see that some components are quite similar and you can just merge them together and get rid of unnecessary things which you don't need anymore. The biggest batch of advantages sits with UX. If you do your research, then you know your customer and you can make sure that what you build will have clear user journeys and that you can improve your website usability for your customers. And you can remove redundant steps to reach desired content and functionality, because when the website are like 3, 4 more years old, they grow organically, and adding new features and pages may not always be the proper process. So that can become a little monster, which you have to deal with and improve when you have a chance. And also, the next slide, please. About reviewing content, you remove duplicated information. And what is very important, you think about accessibility. You review the language and make sure that all people can read and understand your language. If possible, you can rewrite it and make sure it's plain English. And accessibility in general is a very vast topic, as Sylvain already mentioned. And it's not just a legal requirement. It's about making sure that all your customers are included, that anyone can use your website, can use your services. So there is a big opportunity to think about it as well. And the third batch of improvements can be around preparing your team. First of all, you can realize how much content you have, or maybe how much content you yet not have published on the website and you need to do that, or how much content you don't really need to have on the website. And also while reading that, you can see if your language is easy to understand and suitable. And maybe it's a very good time to think about your content standards. If you don't have any content standards, you can create them or update current if you have one, because those standards can change over time. And again, make sure that you have your stakeholders And especially if you need to approve anything with your legals, make sure to book them in advance, not to stop you from progressing. Do you want to have a small tip? Just be user-friendly. That's the main thing you can do while working on your website, be user-friendly. But I also have a few more tips for you. And as a summary of what I was talking about, like a recap, I want to reinforce a few things I was talking about. Content first. Believe me, you won't regret if you think about your content before doing actual designs and the build. This will save you lots of time, money, and nerves. Make sure that there is a user need. Use analytics and research to validate all your assumptions and do and build what your users need, not what you think your users need. Next slide, please. Also, when you understand that your content is not quite fit the purpose, but you can't rewrite it because of different reasons, try at least to add some summaries, make that content structured, add some headers, use layout and styles to help people to read that. And while designing that, we also try to reuse consistent design elements. Again, it makes just easier for customers to get acquainted with the website, and consistent design helps them to perceive the information properly. Next slide, please. So these topics we just covered very slightly, accessibility, content strategy, migration, they're very vast topics. And we do have some other webinars we held here in CyberDuck. So we encourage you to reach out to us if you're interested in those topics, and we can send you the links to see those webinars with more information, more detailed information. And obviously stay tuned. We will be having other webinars regarding those topics and Drupal and Acquia as well. So thank you. That's it from me.
Thank you very much for that. So just before we get onto the Q&A session, just a quick summary of what we've been hearing from our speakers today. So I think one of the key things at the moment is not to delay your upgrade planning. As Sylvain spoke at the start of the presentation, really you want to be on Drupal 9 now, and be part of Drupal's continuous innovation journey. As we know, migrating to Drupal 9 can be time consuming and expensive, particularly if you are still on Drupal 7. But companies like CyberDuck and also Acquia are here to help, particularly with tools like Acquia Migrate, which really can accelerate this process and allow you to kind of focus on elevating the rest of your website. So as we believe, get your team involved in the upgrade strategy. Get a broader look at this and use it as an opportunity to really create a website that is more user-focused, improving your content and improving your accessibility. It's something we say a lot at CyberDuck, is that it is always a good time to review your website, user experience, content strategy, and accessibility. So as I said earlier in the talk, we already have a lot of material out there, CyberDuck, around Drupal 9, the benefits of Drupal 9, and how you as a business can get ready for Drupal 9. So one of the first things I would say is download our ebook if you haven't already. It's a great first step to get you understand a bit more about why Drupal 9 is so important for people who are using Drupal websites. As well as that, Acquia have their own ultimate guide to Drupal 9, which again, I believe is essential reading. We will be, after this webinar, send you a link. We'll send you an email with links to the landing page where you can download this material from. And again, if you have any kind of Drupal challenges, if you want to know more about Drupal 9, I want to know more about kind of Acquia, the different software they have and the benefits of Acquia, then we are all always available for a virtual coffee. You can reach us at hello@cyber-duck.co.uk. And we are across all major social media channels. So Twitter, we're @cyberduck_UK. And on LinkedIn, we're linkedin.com/company/cyber-duck. And again, if you use the Twitter hashtag, hashtag Drupal Duck, we'll pick up on any kind of questions you might have there or anything you want to share with us. So I believe we've already had quite a few questions through, and I know that some of us, both Dave and Sylvan, have been jumping into the channel to answer them. But I think it'd be great just to start with this one, which is, when you say Drupal 7 will become insecure, does it mean that there won't be any paid maintenance services for Drupal 7 if you are unable to upgrade on time when it comes to end of life? Sylvan, can you just quickly jump in to answer that?
Yeah, sure. Thanks for the question. So yeah, when we said end of life, that means the core and I guess most of the community won't be providing ongoing security support or improvements to the existing functionality. So there will be, I don't have any names yet, but I'm sure there will be companies that offering ongoing support. So you will be able to purchase probably ongoing support from private partners. I feel it's just going to be quite expensive because developers won't like working on 15-year-old code, and it's not going to be the last shiny and exciting tools and framework. So it's going to get more expensive. And yeah, as I said, it's just going to be kicking the can down the road. So I don't think it's a long-term solution to plan for private support. They would probably be available by some companies.
That's great. We had a question here, and I know you provide some useful links. It'll be brilliant to raise this with the rest of our attendees. Is, are there any methods to migrate views from Drupal 7 to Drupal 9, even if imperfectly, and web forms? So maybe both yourself, Sylvan, and Dave could jump in on that a bit.
Yeah, we get into kind of custom migration, where there have been open source projects from the community to try and solve that challenge. I guess you're not the first one to have that question, and some people have actually implemented it. We have not tested it at CyberDuck. I haven't tried the specific modules, but yeah, we've shared a few links around kind of documentation and from the forum or other blog articles that suggest it is possible. The web form could be a bit trickier. Depends if you want just the form or just migrate the submission, and depends on how you've configured the module. So I think to get a perfect answer, it's probably possible. It will require some custom development time, but we'll probably need to do a better audit to confirm any more details.
That's great. Maybe Dave, apologies, Dave.
Yeah, so I can probably add that our Migrate Accelerated Development team have tested the Views migration module that we linked there, and they've had a lot of success with that. So I can vouch for that one on their behalf. But yeah, as Sylvan said, I can't really. The web forms one is a bit trickier, but I have seen people talk about success with it.
And maybe just to kind of tie back to this question as well, Dave, is can we migrate from D7 to D9 directly using this Migrate Workbench?
Yeah, sure. I mean, the simple answer is yes, that's exactly what it does. It migrates you from D7 to D9. The option to move to D8 actually isn't there. It was considered, but there's really no point since, as I think Selva might have mentioned already, end of life for Drupal 8 is already November this year. So everyone needs to get onto Drupal 9.
We have another question here is, just to quickly follow that one up, is there any demo available for Migrate Accelerator?
What was the question? Is there like an online demo available?
Yeah, is there any demo available for the Migrate Accelerator?
I probably should know what's on our website. There probably is one there. We can certainly schedule one if anyone wants to have. Give me a couple of minutes. Is this in the chat? I can answer this directly.
Yes, yeah, so this is in the Q&A section.
Okay. Yeah, let me have a look and I'll come back to you in a minute. Just have a look on the website. It's probably there.
So maybe we could jump to this question. Is how easy is it to migrate multi-site D7 to D9?
Yeah, so again, because in D9 it's part of the core. So if don't remember in D7 how that was done, but yeah, the the Acquia migrate again will highlight any inconsistencies or incompatibilities between the components. So again, we'll have to see how it was built in the 7. If it is if it's using the popular kind of community module, there will be an upgrade path. But again, need to see how it's been configured. Could be a few days or it could be a few weeks. It's hard to say until we see the code and how it's been done on your site. But it is possible.
We have another question here. How much does it cost 80% faster migration, 50% less or 50% higher since Acquia accelerator tools are used? It's maybe a question for Dave to...
I think that might be directed at me. I'm not completely sure I understand the question, but to clarify, it will be up to 80% faster. It largely depends on the complexity of your site. As I've discussed earlier, it picks the things that it can automate and that are easy. But if you've got a really complex site, you're going to need more developer and involvement. And what the tool does is define what really needs a developer and what actually doesn't. Whether it's 50% more or less largely depends on your current total cost of ownership and what it would be if you moved to Acquia Cloud.
We have another question here. How easy is it to migrate Drupal 7 bibliography content to D9, given that it doesn't seem to be compatible module in D9, or is there a recommended compatible bibliography module?
I'm not too familiar with this one, to be fair, so we'll have to research. If you can share your details in private messages, we'll follow up on this one. If there is no, we'll have to understand exactly what your module does. If there is no compatible module for D9, we will have to extract what would recommend is extracting the raw data from D7 in whatever format, could be down to a CSV file and linked to the assets, and then either rebuild it with a core module or another similar module that does either most of it or other features maybe in D9, and then re-import that. Most of the module have this import process. So as long as we can extract the data, if you have access to the database, there's probably a way to reload it onto a new module or a new custom kind of content type that we would build in D9. So it's probably possible, but if you want, we can have a look again and as a follow-up offline if you want.
We have another question here. Can we use drush migration commands with Acquia Migrate Accelerator? If yes, which one is faster, drush or accelerator module?
Interesting question. So a lot of what Migrate Accelerate does is, as I mentioned earlier, it migrates things that it can that you don't need to use Drush for. But the Migrate, there is Drupal does provide a migration API. And at some point, you'll probably need to run Drush commands anyway to get the parts that still need migration beyond what Migration Accelerate can do. It's not a tool that does, it's not a magical tool that does everything for you. It simply just takes the easier things that do actually require a lot of involvement, but not necessarily a lot of human analysis out of the migration equation.
We have a question here. How do we take care Drupal distribution while migrating from D7 to D9?
So what do you mean? Is it about running the upgrade process in parallel there? Or
I think so.
Yeah, to upgrade to from D7 to D9, again, you need to be on the latest version of D7. So it's almost like a two-step process where you need to upgrade to the latest patch of D7. So all the core and security and all your modules updated to the latest version, and only then you can go to D9. So again, on the Acquia Migrate, as Dave explained, it creates a separate environment. So your site continues to run on D7. You have a new environment in parallel that has the upgraded version of it, and you decide when you switch over. And if you don't use Acquia Migrate, again, it's a similar process where you create a separate, you create a new instance of D9, do the iterative migration over a few weeks, a month, and then when you're ready, you switch over. That's the kind of the big bang approach when you relaunch all of it. If not, edge case scenario, if you need it earlier, you could launch with a lesser version of the D9 website or have two sites running in parallel live, but that's more complicated. It's only kind of edge cases would recommend that. So I think that I hope that answers your question, Johnny Kant.
I think we've got another question here for you, Sylvain. What features will be specific to Drupal 9 and how can I motivate stakeholders to upgrade before D7 end of life?
Yeah, so that's a good question. Yeah, the stakeholder in terms of depends which layers. For your content editors, they would have a new kind of easier to use interface with the layout builder, better workflow management, better media management. So that's for the day-to-day use. But if you're talking about higher up the chain and thinking about budget and CapEx and how to invest into that migration project, I think it's back to the efficiency slide that I mentioned earlier, where as you run outdated software that's no longer supported, everything will take longer to change. You won't have a lot of the improvements. You're going to pay more for ongoing security patches because it's going to be less and less available. So again, it's an easy business case to build, and we can help you put some numbers together based on the size of your site, the number of users, and the version that you're on. So again, feel free to reach out and we'll help you build a business case.
That's a good one. Actually, this is a question we've got in a couple of our previous webinars as well. What's it mean if I don't update Drupal 7 before November 2022, which is obviously the end of life date?
Yeah, I think we've covered that in the first question about potentially having some private support or organization doing kind of paid patching post that date, but it's not a long-term solution. It's gonna be expensive. You're not gonna have the best developers working on it, and it's not a long-term solution.
Got a question here as well. I have a lot of custom modules. How easy is it to convert those to Drupal 9?
When it's custom, yeah, that could be tricky. It depends what they do. So if it's if they were done as custom modules because your previous developer was lazy maybe or didn't find the right core feature or didn't know how to configure it, it might just be a simple rewrite where we can take some of the function and rewrite them into the new framework. But if there is more complex integration, it could be quite substantial. So as I said, the underlying framework under the hood has changed. We can rewrite the code and transfer the code over, but it's not a simple copy paste job. Anything custom needs to be audited. We sell a package where we spend a few days looking at your code and making recommendations. So maybe that's one option that we can take offline as well to review.
Right. I think we'll look to answer just kind of two or three more questions. How about this one? What if my D7 website, I think we've answered this one. Am I able to migrate all content? Is there any content I can't migrate?
Content. I think, yeah, if it's content that you already have on your site and that, yeah, you have access to it, if it's in the database, we can get it. We can kind of export it and put it in the new D9 version. So that if it's already in Drupal, you can. If any content that you can't migrate, I think it depends where that content is stored. If it's an external CRM, you'd have to rebuild that connectivity. Anything that could be encrypted potentially might be tricky, but for most of it, kind of content, media, assets, uploaded files, all of that we're able to migrate between 7 and 9. Yeah.
And maybe we can finish off on this question. How does this work when I'm developing my new website in parallel to my live D7 website?
Yeah, so I think it's a point we touched on earlier, where we recommend doing it in parallel, really. So you will have this new platform in parallel of your live website that we iterate over, migrate the content, migrate the theme, and then run kind of testing on this new environment. And when you're happy with the new version, you change your domain and replace your old website and you're on the latest version. So I think that's, for most websites, that would be the recommended approach. And as I said earlier, there might be some edge cases where you could do it one section at a time and have multiple sites running in parallel. But that's what we've done with the College of Policing at the time, with a new beta site and an older version. But obviously, it's a bit more complex in terms of how you manage the content and make it clear to the users that there's multiple websites to interact with.
I've just got one more through, actually, which I think is a really nice kind of question maybe to finish on, is when is approximately D10's release planned? And what is your advice? Wait for D10 or go ahead with D9?
Yeah, so Drupal 10 is currently announced for June 2022. So you might say, well, Drupal 7 is until November 2022, so might as well go from 7 to 10. But no, that's the wrong approach, because first of all, it would only give you a few months. So first of all, it's assuming Drupal 10 will be in June 2022. And usually they've been pretty good with the release schedule, so I'm confident it will be. But it will be the new version, and you don't want to be the first one necessarily to upgrade on it. Then it only gives you a few months before Drupal 7 is unsupported. And as we've said, it could be quite a substantial amount of work. So you don't want to rush between July and October 2022 to take the risk of making sure you have a smooth migration in only a few months. And the last point is that Drupal 10 is actually going to be a seamless transition from Drupal 9. So basically, it won't even be, it was just be another small patch that you I think the last version of Drupal 9 would be the same as the first of Drupal 10 or something like that. So you don't even need to talk about migration anymore. So based on those three things, it's time to go to Drupal 9 now, and then you will automatically get to Drupal 10 next year when it's stable and released.
Great. Actually, we still keep having some questions through. And another really great one is, we have mostly problems with migration of paragraphs from 7 to 8/9. Do you have any recommendations?
Anything, Dave, from your side? Or is it, I know it's paragraph kind of the less and less popular now with the new layout builders and those type of thing, but I know it's been widely used in D7. So what's the but I think there is a version for Drupal 9. I'm pretty sure there is.
Yeah, I don't have a recommendation outside of the Acquia platform. If you're on the Acquia platform, then you could use the Migrate Accelerate tool and it'll do it for you. But manually, I couldn't offhand offer any suggestions off that.
Yeah, I'll again refer to my tech team, and we'll get your details and follow up offline if that's okay.
Yeah, that's great. And I think to all of our attendees, if there's any more details to your questions you want, or you have any other questions for us, our kind of contact details are just in the bottom right here. So again, feel free to email us at hello@cyber-duck.co.uk. And as I said before, we're on social media, so we're always happy to kind of jump in and help out where we can. So just to say thank you again to Dave, to Sylvan, to Lisa for their fantastic talks.